involved myself in life for as long as I can remember, even since I was a child, has been that of an exploration of what is my life about and why am I here and that sort of thing, and trying to gain some sort of understanding. And I think that that's kind of been the big driver of my life. And consequently, my art just sort of reflects that. You know, it just sort of becomes a sort of external manifestation of what is going on with me internally. And so my paintings become sort of a diary or a visual journal of that experience. And a lot of times I don't even know why I'm painting what I'm painting. I just, one day I look at it and I realize it's reflecting something that's been going on for a while, and I make that connection. Oh, that's why, you know, that's why that was there. And so that's what, inspires my work. And it's not something that it's not even a decision I feel like I've made. It's just, it's made for me. You know, it simply is the way I live and how my art comes out. I remember I was kind of the guy in class that the teacher always called upon to do the artistic project, because she knew that I had that skill and encouraged, you know. But I wanted to be a musician, and that's what I pursued, and it didn't work out. And it wasn't until my mid-20s when I kind of gave that up. I went back to the community college to get a degree in computers so I could get a decent job. I took a light drawing class as an elective. Doing the first drawing, which was a gesture drawing of a life model, and first 30 seconds, I knew it. I just knew it. There was this thing that came over me, a feeling, I can't describe it. It was just this overwhelming feeling of that I had encountered myself. And I knew that that's what I wanted to do. Here was this great tradition. It had established way of doing this work, and for me that was so attractive. You know, this idea is like, I want certainty. You know, I was in a lot of emotional pain at the time. I didn't understand why. So this seduction of this idea of, like, you know, here's a concrete answer. The fundamentalist religion that I was involved with right around the same time that I started doing this work was so attractive to me. I mean, it was just, you know, here's the answer. We have the answer. It's real. It's perfect. And if you do A, B, and C, you're okay. And doing that sort of work was all about doing A, B, and C. You know, here it is. Here's the mode, and here's how it works. I think it's a matter of personal honesty, you know, about being just coldly honest with myself. And that's not an easy thing, you know. Genius to me is about residing in the space of producing and creating and living a life that is truly who I am and purely who I am.
Thank you so much for coming tonight. I was out on a walk this afternoon about 4 o'clock, and I had been wondering all week long how I'm going to introduce Roy. Because when he gave me his resume, unlike every other resume that any normal person would give you, it would start when they graduated from college. Roy's resume started at the age of 4. All these little moments at 4 years old, 6 years old, 7 years old, it's up on the wall now. That's what happened. So now I'm going to introduce my friend Roy James. We begin in Alamogordo, New Mexico, in 1961, but it didn't last long. 6 months later, Roy and his siblings and parents moved to El Paso. At the age of 4, enamored with the Beatles, Roy decided he wanted to be a rock star. He will prove to you later that dreams die hard. In 1968, Roy's mother takes him to see 2001, A Space Odyssey. Roy spends the next year drawing spaceships, spacemen, planets, and very cool James Bond cars.
Yeah, because she took us to see James Bond, too. So I have to say this about my mother. I mean, anyone who takes a 7-year-old boy to go see 2001 Space Odyssey is
cool.
A great mother.
Yeah, yeah. And James Bond, too.
And James Bond, you know, yeah.
1979, you draw your first truly artistic drawings. Mikhail Baryshnikov flying through the air, which I think was a famous poster, too. And Dan Fogelberg singing. Your mother still has these drawings?
Yeah.
Framed at home?
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Yeah.
You then majored in piano at UTEP. And you say to kill time while waiting to become a rock star?
Yeah, I graduated out of high school. I didn't want to go to college. I wanted to be a musician. I'd been playing for about 7 years. I just thought, go to college and, you know, study music so I could at least know what I'm doing. I had learned to play entirely by ear. So I took I took some piano classes in college, and the head of the piano department sort of singled me out. He said, you know, you're pretty good. You could probably major in piano if you wanted to. And so I said, yeah, sure, you know.
In 1982, Roy wrote the song Money Talked, which became a local favorite. The 45 jumps the local charts to the top 10. A spot it holds for several weeks and makes the band celebrities among the local 13-year-old girl demographic. He was 21 years old then.
Yep.
In 1985, after achieving local notoriety and success, the band migrates to Austin. In 1986, you leave the band and form your new group, the Scary Canary.
That's right.
It's an alternative pop rock band, which has promise. Not much, though. After five shows, you stop.
Yeah.
Right. That promise was short-lived.
No, it actually had promise. We had a good manager. We were playing good shows. The last show we did was at Liberty Lunch, a great venue in Austin from many years ago, and it was a sold-out night. We were the opening act for the Meat Puppets, but we got great attention, and the next day I quit.
That was it.
And the reason I quit was because I hated the music scene. It was hard to find people you could rely on, and not that I was very reliable myself. But, you know, I had so much invested in becoming a successful musician, and it wasn't happening, and I was so discouraged that I just walked away from it.
In 1988, you take a life drawing class. I guess that was a big moment, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was critical. A friend of mine had invited me to take this class with her, and I went in there, started drawing. It was a gesture drawing, and I swear, it's just a feeling, this visceral feeling that I had just come over my entire body that I knew what I wanted to do. And it was so welcome because I thought I'd wanted to be a musician for my whole life, and then there was this period after I left the band that I was back in school, and I didn't know what I wanted to do. I was studying computers, but I really didn't like them. I just thought I could, you know, make a living at them. So there was this period where I did not know who I was or what I wanted to do. And then when I took this class, it just hit me. And I'll never forget it. It was something that really, I just knew it. I knew in that moment.
You graduate with a 2-year degree, adapted for graphic design, and immediately begins working for contract graphic design jobs around town. This is the most amazing part of your life to me coming up. Those of you that know Roy well probably know this, but when I heard he worked for Dell, it blew my mind. I mean, come on. So in 1991, until 1998, a long time, you're at Dell as a graphic designer. And you do big things, right?
Yeah.
Would you like to share one of those?
Oh. My claim to fame is that one day my supervisor walked in and she said, they're designing the new Dell box, and they've got all these people from different firms, you know, presenting stuff. Do you want to do something? Because you've got 2 hours if you want to do it. So I sat there and figured out how to wrap the E part of the logo around the box, and created this little paper box that I took in and showed, and they were like, "That's what we want to do." And so I basically designed the Dell box for, I don't think they're using it anymore, but for many years they did. And I would see this thing everywhere. I did a show at Concordia years ago, and I was talking about it, and this guy came up to me afterwards, and he was an artist as well, and he said, "Oh, so you designed the Dell box?" "Well, I designed the Budweiser can." All right, you got me.
Still does. While at Dale, on your own, and with a couple of months' worth of semi-private lessons, you developed your painting technique focused on the old master's painting method.
I would look at old master paintings, and I literally feel very emotional when I saw them. And I got a UT library card. You can get those even if you're not a student. And I would check out 30 books at a time. I'd take them home. I would just go through the pictures, go to the next one, go through the pictures. And I was just voraciously taking all this visual input in about art and painting. But originally for me, it was old masterwork. It was so just sublimely beautiful. And so that's what I wanted to do. And I was very cocky. I remember I had never painted before. I'd taken drawing, but I'd never painted. And I thought, I'll bet you I could oil paint an old master painting. It would be easy. Went out and bought a cheap canvas and some paints, and kind of just out of my head drew this figure of a woman. And then I started painting it, and it was looking terrible, and then worse and worse. And I was so discouraged. In the end, it was just a mess. I just threw it away. And I almost quit art right then and there. And I said, no, just take your time. Let's copy something. So I found a book, had this angel stabbing this sort of dragon-like creature. But I did it, and it looked wonderful. And I found out that there was somebody in town who gave lessons in old master style painting. And I called her, and I took this painting, and she looked at it, and she said, "Oh, you already know what to do. You just don't know what you're doing." Mm-hmm. And she said, "It's all subconscious. You know how to make it happen, but you have no idea how you're making it happen." Mm. So she said, "I'm going to break it down in some simple form so you understand what it is that you're already doing, and then you can start to control it."
In 1992, Roy took two of these old master's copies to be framed at Tarrytown Gallery. And when he returned, he was told that several people had wanted to buy them.
I was definitely closed off to selling the work. You know, I was afraid, and you know, this is a thing that a lot of artists go through, where they're afraid of getting ripped off or taken advantage of. They don't know how to price their work. They don't know the value of it, and that's kind of the space I was in. And also an emotional belief system that's, do I even deserve it? You know, do I deserve this kind of, do I deserve to do what I love to do and live a happy life? Really, that's the big thing. I, in my mind, said, I'm gonna paint another painting. This is the cockiness again. I'm gonna paint another painting. This one's gonna be original, but it's gonna be based on old master paintings. And I am gonna take that back to that same gallery. I'm gonna ask them to frame it. And when I go back, they're going to say, "Hey, a lot of people wanted to buy this. You know, will you sell it?" And that's exactly what happened. I literally dropped the painting off. 2 weeks later, came back and said, "Look, we've had people want to buy this painting. Do you want to sell it?" And the group I was in at the time, the therapy I was doing, they said, "You should say yes. I want to sell it, and I want to have a show." And so that's exactly what I did. I said, "Yeah, I'll sell it, and I want to have a show." And he said, "Okay, in 8 months, let's do a show." And so 8 months later, I had my first show at that gallery. It was my official opening. And by the end of the show, we'd sold a lot, and I made a lot of money, you know, which for me was incredible. And going back to wanting to be a rock star, first thing I did was buy a great guitar.
You begin painting your first abstracts in 2001, correct?
Yeah.
When I was reading this, it reminded me of a famous saying about abstract art. Abstract art, a product of the untalented, sold by the unprincipled, to the utterly bewildered.
So true, so true.
2 out of 3 anyway.
Abstract work has been actually much more difficult for me in my life because, you know, when I was young and I'm doing skeletons and whatever, you know, copying what I saw was easy. So doing old master style work, it just made a lot of sense to me. I understood that. But abstract work had a lot of built-in uncertainty, sort of a release of control. And that was not an easy thing for me.
One more. Jeff Koons. I think about my work every minute of every day.
He's got to get a life.
There's still too many dogs.
I don't, but I think about it a lot. I mean, I'm constantly creating, but I don't know. I like the idea of having a balanced life or striving for a balanced life.
What do you use for the other part of the balance? Because you're painting.
Well, I love music, but more than anything, I love friends. Yeah. I love my friendships. And I feel like if I'm on my deathbed, what am I going to regret? And I don't think I'm going to regret not having painted a lot of paintings. I'm going to regret not having spent a lot of time with the people I love. And so that's the most important. That's the place that I go to for balance.
So now I'm going to open the audience up to ask Roy a question or two or three. So somebody go for it.
You went through some distinct periods, the old master, the constructs. What's next? What advice?
There's a small body of work that I've just started creating called Illuminated Manuscripts. And they're these internally lit books on where I'm painting oil paintings on Mylar. And I'm wanting to create a large volume of books. And they're not for sale. It's just going to be this sort of expanding volume that I want to create and sort of leave when I go, you know? And one of my favorites, there's a series which is my favorite so far called The Book of Breath, where I just take a sheet of this Mylar, lay it down, and I put some paint down, and I just blow on it and create form out of the breath. I like the idea that, you know, the artist can create with his breath. He doesn't even have to touch it with his hands. He can create, and that sort of connects with sort of mythologies of groups of people who have believed that, you know, God created the world when he breathed or she or whatever. But also, a simple breath can create something beautiful.
Time for one more. Please.
When you move to the construct, or when you have these new ideas, is there someone that you talk to about that? I mean, do you go to your buddies and say, I'm thinking about doing this, what do you think?
I usually just do it. Yeah. But usually it'll take a while. I might bring it up in conversation, but it's not part of my creative process. I usually just, one day, okay, I'm finally going to do this. Like, I'm doing something right now, and it may work, it may not work, but I took a vat, sort of like a plexi tray, and just got all this acrylic paint and just all these different colors and squeezed them in and let it level out. And then when it dried, and it took months to dry because it was like this deep, I painted some white oil paint over it, and now I'm going to paint a beautiful old master style landscape on that. And then I'm going to carve it up and pull all of that paint out that's underneath it, you know? And so it's just an idea I've had in my head for years. And then one day I was at the art store and was like, oh, I'll buy these things now. And then they were sat in the studio for a few months, and one day I just gooped them all out. And now they've been sitting in my studio in the tray for about 6 months. So eventually I'll get in there and do that painting. But that's kind of how the process goes for me.
We have to come to the last part of the evening. I'm going to ask Roy 15 rapid-fire questions. He's not allowed to think. He can only respond.
I may have to think.
You cannot think.
I can't help it. I don't know how to shut that down.
You cannot think. You only can react. Are you ready?
Okay.
What do you value most in friends?
Integrity.
The quality you like most in men?
Strength.
The quality you like most in women?
Honesty.
What is good art?
Whatever I like.
What's your favorite food?
I like hot dogs.
What's your favorite band?
Radiohead.
I knew you were gonna say that. What's your favorite word?
I don't know. Oh, wait. Flow. Right now, flow is my favorite word.
Flow is a good word. Finish this thought. The secret to creativity is?
Is surrender.
What is your dream of happiness?
I think it's contentment, you know, just acceptance.
What's your most dominant characteristic?
Perseverance.
I agree. Yeah. What natural gift would you like to possess?
I'd like to be a rock star.
I told you dreams die hard. Finish this thought. There is no time for...
bullshit.
Last question. What's next?
I don't know, but I can't wait.
Bravo.